Hi there, I'm Dr. Tanya. I'm also known as Dr. Cutris, and today I'll be answering a couple of questions for you guys. Let's start with why am I called Dr. Cutris? So I thoroughly believe that the uterus is the most important organ in our body. Without the uterus, we wouldn't be here. There's so many people that do talk about, there's a lot of emphasis that's given to neurosurgeons and to cardiologists, but we just don't give enough importance to the uterus and people who specialize, in work related to the uterus. Everybody that is walking on the face of the earth, every single human being has come out of a uterus. So I think the uterus is a wonderful organ. It's our first home, and I feel like it deserves that credit and it deserves that honor. So cute plus uterus is Dr. Cutris. So I really started my page in May of 2019. I had gone to the UK to do a master's program, and over there I started using a menstrual cup. Really enjoyed it, got it back for a lot of people who wanted it, and I would always have to explain how it works and what it does. So I had just moved into the storeroom of my house at that time, and both my parents are doctors and they deal in the fertility world, so we have lots of models of uteruses lying about in the house. I picked up one of the models and I was like, why don't I use this to explain how a menstrual cup works? And I made a series of stories that I just randomly posted on my private Instagram account, and people seem to really like it, so they said you should make this public. And while I was growing up, especially when I was in medical school, I had this idea that I will one day grow up to have my own medical education channel on YouTube, because I did a lot of my education on YouTube. Like, a lot of things that I don't understand even to this day, the complicated medical things, I look to YouTube because there's lots of very good teachers on it, and this is exactly what I thought I would do. And I thought, might as well do this. So I made the public account and I started posting about this. But unfortunately, I couldn't dedicate a lot of time because at that time I was still shuttling between India and the UK. So I did maybe 10-15 posts in the entire year. And then last year in January 2020, I was there at a conference and I was sort of live covering the conference. It was an obstetrics and gynecology conference, and from there on I became very, very strict about posting regularly and actually, doing something with my Instagram and actually really putting out some information out there. And then I've really been at it for 1 year, but technically the account is 2 years old. It really is very exhausting to constantly keep creating content while also working as a doctor, while also studying for further studies. So I won't deny that it's very exhausting, and because of that I have prolonged social media breaks as well, where I just go off the grid for a week or so, and then within that week there's so many questions that come to my mind, there's so many questions that come in my DMs, there's so many questions that I think that I would ask if I didn't have the medical background that I have. And based on these, I decide to make content. I think I'm genuinely really inspired by the fact that this kind of stuff really makes a difference. When I started doing this, I was only doing it because I felt like there wasn't enough information around it. But then as my channel grew, I realized what an impact it has had on people. And people genuinely found this useful, and that was a very enriching experience for me. So I think it comes from the fact that people are finding answers that they didn't find before. And if I can provide it in any way, if I've had the training in medicine, and if I can use that to provide this kind of information, I would happily do it every day for the rest of my life. Yes, I will take breaks because, between work and studies, it gets a little bit hectic. But it's very gratifying, that feeling when somebody actually understands how, say, your menstrual cup works, or how their vulva works, or how childbirth happens, or how contraception happens. And that feeling, it's just irreplaceable. So I think that's where the inspiration comes from. While I am one of the few people on social media who are actually licensed and qualified to offer the kind of sex education that we do, there is also the fact that because of that, I believe that people think it's, for some reason it's thought lowly of me to be talking about these things. It's not considered very nice. A lot of people don't appreciate that. I get a lot of trolling, I get a lot of hate messages, but I think unfortunately that's a part of being a person on the internet, particularly a woman on the internet. And on top of that, a woman on the internet who talks about sex, I think that is something that would inconsequentially happen to me. I'm not saying that's right, but it's very much a part and parcel of being a vocal person on the internet. So yes, there is a lot of trolling, but I think you develop thick skin to it over some time. So dealing with unsolicited messages, pictures, comments, all of those things has actually become very, very easy on social media now, because I very, very, very frequently and very, very, very freely use the block, report, restrict features. I don't engage with people who, you know, I think earlier I genuinely wanted to engage with these people and figure out why they think this way and change their minds on it. But I understand my bandwidth is limited and some people generally do this for trolling. So I think over time you start to realize who's doing this for trolling and who's doing this for actually, you know, because they actually disagree and they actually do want to engage in a positive dialogue and put forth their views in a positive manner. So you develop a sort of radar almost, and if my radar doesn't, you know, sense that this person is engaging in a productive conversation, I just restrict, block and delete. That works very well. So yes, I am a collaborator in a fertility related startup, and I'm also working on other startup projects with other people. I think the way medicine is changing has been very, very dramatic and has been very, very it's been an exponential growth in the area, which is wonderful, because the more and more we're able to engage technology in improving the lives of other people, the more and more we can impactfully do some work with it. The more and more we can improve the quality of life of people and improve the standards of living in whatever limited way medicine can. Actually, I don't think it's a limited way. I think it's a very, very massive way. And there's a lot that's happening, you know. There's things like Neuralink, where people are using, implantable devices to stimulate movement in people who have some kind of a disability, for example, paraplegia, quadriplegia. There is also things like, you know, like IVF in itself. Like I work in the fertility field. IVF itself is a consequence of the technological boom we've experienced in the past 50 years or so. IVF was developed, which is in vitro fertilization. It's a process that was developed to help people who were not able to conceive to have a child. And, you know, I think that's wonderful. You know, LGBT families are being able to have children now with their own gametes oftentimes. So it has been a very lovely couple of years, and I see that it's going to go even bigger, and I'm very excited to see what happens in the future. Yes, I like to say that my job on the internet is to put the fun in fundamental sex ed, and I genuinely enjoy talking about our bodies and sharing more information and learning more about it. This is something I do even on my downtime. You can find me watching videos on, you know, just body related stuff. I'm a doctor and that's my primary work. All of my work is, you know, sort of centered around medicine. All of my interests also have something to do with medicine in one way or the other. Actually, no, not all, some of them, most of them. And I think it's when I lived in a developed country for a while and I saw the impact of preventive healthcare and how it can reduce future issues and it can reduce the global burden of healthcare costs and it can make a massive impact on people's qualities of life, I think that's where my drive for public health comes from. I really, really, really do believe that the foundation of a good healthcare system is based on preventive healthcare and education. And that's probably what is my biggest drive. I really, really, really genuinely envision that there are people like this that can change the world, who talk about education, doctors who educate people about their bodies in every which way, cardiology, neurology, gynecology, everything. I feel like these are the people that have the power to change the world. And I hope someday we will. Fingers crossed.